a baby. She should just treat me nice.
Christmas was meant to be great, but it's horrible.
Merry Christmas, baby. Should you treat me nice?
This Christmas, though, I assure you, it's not gonna be.
Give me a diamond ring for Christmas. Now I'm living in paradise.
A crate of fine champagne glasses for Gordon Selfridge to offer a toast to decadence. A flaming Christmas pudding for old Fagin. And a powdered wig for Lady Archer to ensure that she, and she alone, will be the belle of the ball. This invitation requests your very presence at a Christmas masquerade in Marks and Sparks.
Sandy came down the chimney.
My masquerade for the ghosts of Oxford Street's past.
That you see before me. Merry Christmas.
This shiny revolver for that great highwayman, Jack Shepherd. And a bottle of laudanum to conjure up old Thomas de Quincy's celestial dreams.
But I'm all lit up like a Christmas tree.
This should all help them on their way. Oxford Street. Stony-hearted stepmother. Do you believe in magic? Then it's no hoax that there's ghosts in Oxford Street. Keep a sharp eye out and you will see a street that's been to hell. Gargoyles of rats in the shadows of cats who wrap their shrouds when winter attacks the ghosts of Oxford Street. Have I walked this street only to discover misery, boredom, and loneliness? If only I could put an end to it. If only I could make my dreams come true. For the ghosts that lie beneath its crumbling facades are my heroes. This Christmas Day, I will reclaim its past. For with these presents, magic's back.
Would you believe in a ghost that loves you? If you do, then your dreams can come true. You don't have to be scared of shadows. Into the light and the spirit will blow magic back. Magic's back. Into the light.
When I was a child, I'd always dream of travelling down the street in a golden carriage. Every year at Christmas, my grandmother would bring me here to Oxford Street. I'd gaze with astonishment at the Christmas lights and at all the shops filled with toys. But then she would tell me fabulous tales of the scoundrels and rogues that once dwelt here. This street became part of our private kingdom, a world of fantasy, an anarchy inhabited only by the two of us. She used to say to me, if you are bad, you are good. If you are good, you are boring. So, who wanted to be boring? Later on, Oxford Street became my battleground. As an art student in the 60s, I went one Christmas to Selfridge's, dressed as Santa Claus, and with my friends began to give away all the toys to passing children, causing great havoc. Boy, oh boy, Christmas, we sang. Let's smash the great deception. For on Oxford Street, I saw that modern life had been reduced to the spectacle of the commodity.
Oxford Street has always seemed to me to be a strange paradise of joy.
Can you believe that Oxford Street was once a lonely country road with green fields on either side? And later lawlessness reigned? Highwaymen even hammered notes to the doors of its wealthy homes, warning the inhabitants that if they dared venture out without 10 guineas and a watch about them, it would be on the pain of death. And these presents are for those whose lives on the street are forgotten. Though this plaque, hidden by traffic at Marble Arch, is the only reminder of those that died on the Tyburn gallows, they say their screams still haunt nearby houses.
For 200 years, those that were convicted of crimes and misdemeanors took their final bow from life right here where Marble Arch now stands. 50,000 met their end on the Tyburn tree. One of them was a Mclaren, an ancestor of mine, who was hung for his part at the Battle of Culloden. Beneath my feet still lie the bones of those that perished at the hands of the hangman.
Monday was execution day, a public holiday, crowds would gather in their thousands to dance and sing at the scenes of death and suffering set before them. In 1724, the great highwayman, Jack Sheppard, drew a crowd of 200,000. Even more flocked to watch his partner in crime, Jonathan Wild, when he was hung the following year. To the roar of the crowd, Wild's last great gesture of roguery was to steal a corkscrew from the alcoholic chaplain's pocket. And he died with it, clasped in his hand. Prisoner's last sight, as the rope was secured around his neck when he stood on the drop, when he was falling through the air with a fragment of a second to live, was of 100,000 demonic faces, whistling and cheering at the grand spectacle of death.